It is a unit 4 of our applied physics course. So in the last class we completed introduction to quantum mechanics, wave particle duality, de Broglie hypothesis. So once again I'm giving a brief information about the last class. Same as radiation, here material particles are behaves both wave and particle nature. So that's why matter waves behaves dual nature, that is wave nature and particle nature. We know very well the experimental evidences for particle for the radiation are black body radiation, photoelectric effect, Compton effect. For radiation, the wave nature experimental evidences are interference, diffraction, polarization. So de Broglie extended the same radiation behavior to material particles also. What are material particles? We know very well, generally electrons, protons, neutrons, so many elementary particles are treated as material particles. So these material particles also behaves as both wave and particle nature by de Broglie hypothesis. So that was discussed in the last class, and also we discussed the properties of matter waves also. If lighter is the particle, greater is the wavelength. If smaller is the velocity, greater is the wavelength, and vice versa conditions. And also here the matter waves are produced by either charged particles or uncharged particles, but radiation can be produced by only charged particles, we know very well. So from the last class we discussed, we know the de Broglie hypothesis, the de Broglie matter waves characteristics. So in this class we are discussing about detection of matter waves, how we can detect the matter waves. We can detect the matter waves with two types of experimental evidences. The first one is Davison and Jermers experiment, and the second one is G.P. Thomson experiment. And next topic we will discuss Heisenberg uncertainty principle. So detection of matter waves. A wave associated with the motion of a material particle is known as matter wave. This is the general definition of matter wave. A moving particle is always associated with the wave. The wave is controlled by the particle. The particle is controlled by the wave. The matter waves are generated by, here the matter waves, matter, please remember that matter means matter wave means electron wave, proton wave, neutron wave, positron wave, like that only. Here matter wave, when we are talking about matter wave means, you should remember that is by either electron or proton or neutron. So here the matter waves are generated by both microscopic and macroscopic bodies. Both type of bodies we can generate the matter waves. However, the wavelengths of matter waves associated with the macroscopic bodies are so small, very, very small. If any matter wave is produced by a macroscopic body, that wave is very small. So that's why they cannot be detected with any instrument. So matter waves can be detected by the microscopic bodies. Before 1924, the electron was exclusively recorded as a particle, but after the suggestion of de Broglie, the electron was given the wave particle duality. That means before 1924, up to people are thinking, scientists are thinking about the electron behaves only particle in nature, but not the wave. But after the de Broglie hypothesis of matter waves, scientists and the people are treating electron possess both particle and wave nature, that is dual nature of matter. There are many experimental evidences which prove that electron is a particle. You know very well photoelectric effect. There the electrons are behaves as the particles. So from that, electrons have already we discussed in the characteristics of particle. Electron possess mass, energy, charge, momentum, etc. So at the same time, there are some experimental evidences which prove that electron has a wave nature. So the experimental evidence of wave nature for radiation is interference and diffraction, but not for the matter wave. So existence of matter waves can be identified with the help of some experimental evidences, that is called the detection of matter waves. So the following are the some experiments which support the wave nature of electrons. The first one is Davison and Germer diffraction experiment. Simply we can call it as Davison and Germer experiment. So this experiment, the basic principle of experiment is diffraction effect. We know very well what is meant by diffraction. Diffraction means the bending of light from the corner of an obstacle which produces its geometrical shadow on the screen. So that is called the diffraction. Already we discussed diffraction is of two types, Fresnel and Fraunhofer. So in that Fraunhofer diffraction, we discussed about single slit, double slit, N slits. So here we are taking the N slit information. Next one is G.P. Thompson experiment. So the first experiment, Davison and Germer diffraction experiment, used the electrons behaves as waves. That means electrons possess wave nature. The G.P. Thompson experiment, the experiment used the which supports the Davison and Germer experiment. That means electrons behaves both particle and wave nature. So the first one, Davison and Germer experiment. The first experimental evidence of matter waves was given by the two American physicists, Davison and Germer, in 1927. So the Davison Germer experiment was discovered by two American physicists. The names of the scientists are Davison and Germer in 1927. That means after the de Broglie hypothesis of matter waves, 3 years. That means later three years, they successfully explained the existence of matter waves with the help of their experiment, that is the diffraction experiment. So they also succeed in measuring the de Broglie wavelength associated with slow electrons. So this is the experimental arrangement of matter waves, that is the Davison and Germer experiment. So the experimental diagram mainly consisting of, this is the electron gun, it is gun shape. This is the electron gun. All of you observe this. This is a electron gun G. So the apparatus mainly consists of an electron gun G. Here the electron gun G produces the electrons, and also to obtain a fine pencil of electron beam of known voltage. Here there are the two points. Here the electron gun produces the electrons and obtained a fine pencil of electron beam of known velocity. That means we know the velocity of electrons also coming from the electron gun. This electron gun mainly consisting of a tungsten filament F. This is the tungsten filament F. This tungsten filament is connected to a battery, and it is connected to a high potential also. This is the high potential, this is the low potential. This low potential is connected to the electron gun. When this filament is heated to a dull red, it produces the electrons. And these electrons are produced due to the thermionic emission. Now the electrons are accelerated in the electric field of known potential difference. Here we are applying a high potential, we are applying a low potential. So electrons are moving from high potential to low potential through the narrow slits. These narrow slits, this is a slit 1, slit 2, slit 3. These three slits are helpful to make the electrons as a fine pencil beam. Why? Because from this tungsten filament, we are getting electrons in all directions. So to make that electrons into a fine pencil beam, we are passing through these narrow slits. So when these electrons are passing through the narrow slits and they are directly incident on a nickel target, here T is nothing but a target. Here we took nickel chloride crystal, which is a single crystal. So this is the crystal folder, we can call it as a crystal folder. Once again, the experimental arrangement mainly consisting of an electron gun. This electron gun produces the electrons, and also to obtain a fine pencil of electron beam with known voltage. There is a first point. And the second point, this electron gun consisting of a tungsten filament. When this tungsten filament is heated to a dull red, it produces electrons in all directions. to make the electrons as a fine pencil beam, we are passing through a narrow slits. So these narrow slits are to make the electrons into a fine pencil beam, and this fine pencil beam of electrons are to be incident on a target. Here the target is a nickel chloride crystal, which is a single crystal. That is very, very important. Here nickel chloride crystal is a single crystal. Here the electrons are emitted from the tungsten filament by the thermionic emission. Here we are applying a potential. This is the high potential, this is the low potential. When we are applying this potential, due to the potential difference, that is voltage V, the electrons are moving from high potential to low potential. So while passing through these narrow slits, the electrons are to become as a fine pencil beam. This fine pencil beam of electrons incident on the target, which is a nickel crystal of single crystal. So here the nickel crystal is placed on a target holder. This arrangement is called as a target holder. We can tilt or we can make with some different angles with the incident beam. Here the incident beam is a direct beam, normal beam incidents on the nickel crystal. We are placing nickel crystal here, single crystal here. When the electrons incidents on the nickel crystal are diffracted in all directions, in upper direction, diffracted light rays electrons in the upper direction and also in downward direction. So here we are placing a electron detector. This is called electron detector C, which is called as Faraday cylinder, electron detector. This Faraday cylinder C is connected to a galvanometer G. So this Faraday cylinder is moved on a circular graduated scale from 20 degrees to 90 degrees. That means when the electron beam incident on a nickel crystal, the electrons behaves as waves and the crystal behaves as a planes. That means the crystal planes behaves as a rulers. The electrons which incident on the rulers are to be diffracted in several directions. The diffracted electrons are to be detected with the Faraday cylinder C. So this Faraday cylinder C is moving on a circular graduated scale from 20 degrees to 90 degrees. Up to this one is 90 degrees. So while moving this cylinder on the circular graduated scale, the galvanometer shows deflections. When the reflected electron beam incident on the cylinder, then the galvanometer shows deflections. Okay, here the Faraday cylinder consists of two walls. You are observing here, this is the outer wall, this is the inner wall. It consists of two walls. These two walls are insulated together. That means they can't touch each other. A retarding potential is applied to this Faraday cylinder so that only fast moving electrons coming from the electron gun are to be entered into the cylinder. The slow moving electrons are to be reflected back. So the cylinder detects only the fast moving electrons. The slow moving electrons are reflected from the Faraday cylinder. In this way, the galvanometer deflection is only due to electrons coming from the electron gun. Okay, so this is the experimental arrangement and the experimental procedure. Okay, once again, here the experiment, the Davison-Germer diffraction experiment, mainly consisting of an electron gun G. Here the electron gun G produces and we can obtain a fine pencil beam of electrons of known voltage, and it mainly consisting of a filament F, tungsten filament. When we are applying a potential difference to this tungsten filament, it heated to a dull red by the thermionic emission. It produces the electrons, and that electrons are moving through the narrow slits with a potential difference. So electrons are moving from high potential to low potential and are to be made fine pencil beam with the help of these slits. So the electron beam incident on a target. Here the target is a nickel crystal, which is a single crystal, placed on a crystal holder or the target holder. So the fine pencil beam of electrons incident on the nickel crystal are to be diffracted in all directions. So the diffracted beam is detected with the help of a Faraday cylinder. Here the Faraday cylinder is connected to a galvanometer, which shows the deflections. Here the Faraday cylinder is moving on a circular graduated scale from 20 degrees to 90 degrees. So, and also here the Faraday cylinder consisting of two walls, and the two walls are insulated to each other. When we are applying a retarding potential to the Faraday cylinder, only fast moving electrons are entering into the cylinder and slow moving electrons are to be reflected back. So here, due to the fast moving electrons enter into the cylinder, the galvanometer shows deflections. Okay, so this is about the experimental arrangement and the experimental procedure. So where, due to the incident on the that means the electron wave incident on the cylinder, due to the variation of the potentials, we are obtaining like this. At 44 volts of input voltage, here the beam is the beam like this. So as voltage increases, the bump gradually increases. From here to here, the bump increases. At 54 volts, the bump increases more. So as the voltage increases, it decreases. We are applying retarding potential here. 44 volt, 48 volt, 54 volt, 64 volt, applying retarding voltage. At a particular voltage of 54, we are applying a maximum bump. That means here the diffraction is maximum. So the Faraday cylinder was moved on a circular scale, and for a given accelerating voltage V, the scattering curve showed a peak in a particular direction. With the electron beam incident perpendicular to the crystal surface, the pronounced scattering direction is to be 50 degree for electron accelerated to 54 volts. Already we showed in the previous diagram. At 50 degree angle of diffraction, that means their deflection, we are getting an accelerated voltage as 54 volts. So according to de Broglie electron wave, we know the last case in the previous de Broglie concept of matter waves, lambda is equal to 12.26 by root V Armstrong. So by substituting all these values, 12.26 by root 54. Here the voltage is 54. That is 1.67 Armstrong. So this is the crystal surface. These are the crystal planes. These are the crystal planes. The distance between two successive planes is called interplanar spacing D. The distance between two successive lattice points is called lattice constant A. Here this is the incident ray on the crystal. The direct electron beam coming from the electron gun incidents on the crystal plane, and it is diffracted like that. So here the total angle is 50 degree. So here the total angle is 180 degree. 180 degree, this is the 90 degree. So this is 25 degree. The remaining is 65 degree. So here also the 65, 65, 65, 130 degree. So remaining is 50 degree. So from X-ray analysis, it is known that a nickel crystal acts as a plane diffraction grating with grating space D is equal to, here the interplanar spacing of the nickel crystal is 0.909 into 10 to the power of minus 10 meter. According to the experiment, here the data is coming from X-ray analysis, not from this experiment. From the crystal, nickel crystal analysis, the interplanar spacing D is equal to 0.909 into 10 to the power of minus 10 meter. We have diffracted electron beam at an angle of 50 degree. The corresponding Bragg's angle, we know Bragg's law, diffraction due to incidence, Bragg's law is equal to 2d sin theta equal to n lambda. Here the theta dash is the Bragg's angle, which is equal to 180 minus 50 by 2. Here that angle is 50. So the total angle is here for 180. So 180 minus 50 by 2 is equal to 65 degree. So this is the angle 65 degree. Using the Bragg's formula, 2d sin theta dash is equal to n lambda, by substituting all the values. Here we know the d value, 0.909 into 10 to the power of minus 10 meter d value. We know theta dash value, 65 degree. We know n, this is the first order, n is equal to 1. So we can calculate the lambda. Lambda is equal to 2d sin theta dash by n. So lambda is equal to, by substituting all the values, we can get lambda is equal to 1.65 into 10 to the power of minus 10 meter, which is nothing but 1.65 angstrom. 1 angstrom is equal to 10 to the power of minus 10 meter. So this value is coming from the potential by the formula. Lambda is equal to 12.26 by root V. So here the V is 54. By substituting that value, we are getting 1.67 angstrom. Here this is the value from the X-ray analysis, that is the diffraction theory. So 2d sine theta dash is equal to n lambda is coming from the diffraction. So from the here the diffraction means the diffraction takes place only due to the waves only, not by the particles. So here the particles are electrons. So electrons behaves as wave, not here in this experiment electron behaves as wave, but in photoelectric effect electron behaves as particle. So the experimental evidence for wave nature of a matter wave or the material particle by Debeson and Germer. So as the two values are in good agreement, here the value is 1.67 angstrom, here the value is 1.65 angstrom. Hence confirms the de Broglie concept of matter. So I will show you. So this is the tungsten filament. So me kanapadutundi andarki, please respond anyone.
Yes sir.
Okay, so this is the electron gun, this is the complete electron gun, this is the filament. So this is a nickel crystal rod. When we are giving the potential difference to this one, this can become as a dull red. So this is the dull red. So it produces the electron beam. So the electron beam is incident on the nickel crystal chloride, nickel chloride crystal. So it diffracts all directions. These are the electron waves. So this is the representation of wave. Observe this. So this is the detector. This is the circular scale. మీకు వినపడుతుందా?
Yes sir.
ఏమా వినపడుతుందా ఇది?
Sir.
వీడియో వినపడుతుందా?
Yes sir.
No sir.
Yes sir.
వీడియో
ఇది చూడండి, మనం మూవ్ చేస్తున్నాం.
Sir.
ఇది మన ఫారడే సిలిండర్. ఈ కింద ఉన్నటువంటిది సర్క్యులేటెడ్ గ్రాడ్యుయేటెడ్ స్కేల్. ఈ సిలిండర్ మూవ్ చేస్తున్నాం మనం. ఎక్కడ మాక్సిమం ఇంటెన్సిటీ వస్తుందో అక్కడ మనం ఫైండ్ అవుట్ చేస్తాం ఈ సిలిండర్ ని ప్లేస్ చేసుకొని. మీకు యూట్యూబ్ లో ఉన్నటువంటిది ఇది ఇదిగోండి చూడండి, 44 వోల్ట్, 48, 54, 64. ఇది ఏమన్నా యాంగిల్, ఇది ఏమన్నా వోల్టేజ్. So this is the phi angle. Observe this phi. So this is the diagram. Maximum voltage we apply, maximum bump here. So this is the bump. This is the bump. So as increasing potential, the bump increases. As potential increases, the bump decreases. So at this point only we are getting the maximum bump, so maximum diffracting angle. Okay. So the next one is G.P. Thomson experiment. So G.P. Thomson performed experiments with electrons accelerated from 10,000 volt to 50,000 volts. The previous experiment, there is no limitation of voltage, very low voltage. Davison and Germer experiment. But here there is a condition. Here the electrons are accelerated from 10,000 volts to 50,000 volts, very, very, very high. In his experiments, he observed diffraction patterns exactly similar to X-rays pattern. So you know very well J.J. Thomson. G.P. Thomson is the son of J.J. Thomson. Both father and son got Nobel Prizes, both people. So with his G.P. Thomson experiments, he got the Nobel Prize. Moreover, he was able to determine the wavelengths associated with the electrons. He mainly, G.P. Thomson focused that electrons behaves as waves, that is diffraction effect, he wants to explain. And also he calculated the wavelength of matter wave, as the same Davison and Germer experiment. So G.P. Thomson experiment supported the Davison and Germer experiment. Thomson experiments supported the concept of matter waves, since the diffraction pattern is possible only if the waves are associated with the material particles. So this is the experimental arrangement for the electron beam diffraction of G.P. Thomson. So here the experimental arrangement mainly consisting of, this is the cathode, we know very well, from the cathode only electrons are to be produced. So the experimental arrangement consisting of mainly the here we are producing a high energy electron beam from the cathode. So this beam is excited with potentials up to 50,000 volts. Already here the range of voltage is from 10,000 to 50,000 volt. A fine pencil beam of electron is obtained by passing it through these slit. The accelerated fine beam of electrons falls on a gold foil or an aluminum foil. Here in the diagram, it is a gold foil. We can use both gold or aluminum. So here the thickness of the aluminum foil or the gold foil is to be very, very small. That is in the order of 10 to the power of minus 6 centimeter. 1 microcentimeter, not a meter. 1 microcentimeter. Here we are placing a photographic film or the photographic plate. So when the electron beam or the electron waves are incident on the gold foil or an aluminum foil, it diffracted in different directions. The diffracted beam is to be incident on a photographic film or a photographic plate. So we can get the diffraction pattern on the photographic plate. Here, this total setup is placed in a vacuum chamber. Why? Because to avoid the loss of energy of the electrons due to collisions with the molecules of the gas. Okay, so once again, this is the experimental arrangement for the G.P. Thomson. The experimental arrangement mainly consisting of a cathode. A high energy electron beam is produced from this cathode. Here we are applying a voltage of 10,000 volts to 50,000 volts. So from that cathode, we are getting a fine pencil beam of electron, and the fine pencil beam of electron is passed through a slit. Yes, here also electrons are going in different directions. To make it to be a fine, we are passing through a slit. So the electron beam is incident on a thin foil. Here the foil is a gold or aluminium. Here the thickness of the gold foil or the aluminum foil is in the order of 1 microcentimeter. When electron beams incident on the thin foil, the electron beams or the electron waves are to be diffracted from the gold or the aluminum. So they are incident on a photographic plate. Here we are placing a photographic plate. Due to that photographic plate, due to the diffraction from the gold foil, from the electron beam, we are getting a concentric circular rings on the photographic plate. Okay, so here this total arrangement is placed in a vacuum chamber so that the electrons may not lose their energy due to the collisions with the molecules of the gas. So this is the photographic plate or the photographic film. Here this is the central spot, so the direct ray coming. But we discussed diffraction due to circular aperture like that. So these are the circular diffraction pattern, circular fringes. The condition for, if it satisfies the condition for bright, we are getting the bright, or that if we are satisfying the condition for dark, we are getting the dark. So that is the point. After developing the plate, that means this photographic plate, a symmetrical pattern consists of concentric rings about a central spot is obtained. This pattern is similar as produced by X-rays. Same here, due to the X-rays also we are getting the same pattern. From this experimental analysis, X-rays are to be waves, they proved initially. So here also we are getting the same pattern. So this electron beam pattern is similar to X-rays. So whether these are X-rays or these are electron waves, we can be identified with the G.P. Thompson experiment. For that, in order to make sure that this pattern is due to electrons and not due to X-rays, for this he applied a magnetic field on the path of electron beam in the discharge tube. That is, during their path, G.P. Thompson applied a magnetic field. He applied a magnetic field. Due to the application of magnetic field, the path of the electron beam shifted either upward or downward by depending upon the magnetic field direction. If we apply a magnetic field, if there is no shift, then these rays are called X-rays. If there is a shift, then these rays are called electron rays. So that is a point here. In order to make sure that this pattern is due to electrons and not due to X-rays, for this he applied a magnetic field on the path of electron beam in the discharge tube. A shift in the electron beam direction has been observed with the applied magnetic field. Due to the application of magnetic field, the beams are to be shifted upward direction or downward direction. It shows that the pattern is produced by electrons and not by X-rays. What happens if the X-rays? If X-rays, they won't be shift either upward or downward by due to the electric or magnetic fields. So the observed rings can be interpreted only by considering the diffraction pattern of the electron beam, which is due to the gold or aluminum foil, as the diffraction pattern can only be produced by waves and not by the particles. Thompson concluded that electron behaves like. So finally, due to the application of external magnetic field, the electron beam, that means the pattern on the photographic plate is to be shifted. So due to the shifting of electron beam or the electron waves on the photographic plate, he concluded that these are due to electrons only, not by the X-rays. If it X-rays, that means the diffraction pattern is due to X-rays, they won't be shifted with either electric or magnetic. So the following conclusions have been drawn from the experiment of G.P. Thompson. That is, Thompson experiment clearly demonstrated the existence of matter waves because the diffraction pattern can be produced by the waves only. The second one, Thompson calculated same from the Davison-Germer experiment. Davison-Germer calculated the wavelength of matter wave. Here also Thompson calculated the wavelength associated with the electrons with the help of diffraction rings. The calculated wavelengths obtained by diffraction pattern agree well with the wavelengths obtained by de Broglie's relation. So from de Broglie's relation, lambda is equal to 12.26 by root V Armstrong. Same he also obtained. The associated wavelength depends only on the accelerating voltage. So here the wavelength depends upon the voltage only. Already we know the calculated formula, lambda is equal to 12.26 by root V. Here the V is potential difference or the voltage, and it is independent of the material of the target, whether the target is gold or aluminum. In the previous case, whether the target is nickel or some other crystal, that depends upon the conditions. Okay, so it is independent of the material of the target. So on the last topic, Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. So for going to Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, I will show the G.P. Thompson experiment video. So here, this is the experimental diagram, same in the previous case, cathode, slit, anode, gold foil, and also here the electrons are moving through the slit, which is passing through the anode, and this is the gold foil. When incidence on the gold foil, it diffracted like this. So So which instance on the photographic plane? So this is the diffraction pattern. This is the diffraction pattern. So already we studied diffraction due to sector aperture. The same thing. Central is bright and the dark, bright and the dark. Okay, so this is about the GP thumb search. So next, Heisenberg uncertainty principle. Due to the dual nature of material particles, it is very difficult to locate the exact position and momentum of the particles simultaneously. So here the dual nature, both particle and wave nature. So it is very hard to locate the position of the particle in the wave. If you are locating the particle position with a desired accuracy, at the same time we can get uncertainty in the finding the momentum of the particles. So this uncertainty was explained by Werner Carl Heisenberg in 1927 through his uncertainty principle. So to understand the uncertainty in the measurement of position and momentum of microscopic particles, let us take the examples of narrow and wide wave packets. Here we are taking the two types of wave packets. The first one is narrow wave packet and the second one is wide wave packet. So this is the narrow wave packet. Here only we are taking only the crust. We are not taking the trough, only the crust only. So it is very hard to determine the wavelength. So with the determination of wavelength only, we can find the momentum. Why? Because wavelength lambda is equal to h by p. What is p? Momentum. So in that momentum, p is equal to mv. So there mass of the particle is constant, but v velocity is variable. So that's why delta p is nothing but m into delta v. Generally we are writing. Okay. So here in this narrow wave packet, it is very hard to find the wavelength, or the it is very hard to measure the wavelength. But if so in narrow wave packet, the position of the particle can be precisely determined. That means we can locate the particle where it is, whether here or here, here or here, but not the wavelength. As a result, the particle's movement cannot be measured accurately, as there are not enough waves to exactly measure the wavelength. So here it is very hard to find the wavelength. So that's why due to the uncertainty in finding the wavelength, we are getting the uncertainty in momentum. But here we can find the position of the particle easily due to the very small extent of displacement of the particle. The next case, on the other hand, in a wider wave packet, this is the wider wave. So we can measure the wavelength. The distance between two successive crests or the two successive troughs is nothing but the wavelength. That means we can find the wavelength with a desired accuracy, but we can't find the position of the particle with a desired accuracy. Why? Because here the particle may be located here or here or here or here. So that is very hard to find. So the wavelength can be determined exactly, but the position of the particle will be uncertainty due to the large width of the wave packet. Due to the large width of the wave packet. Hence, it can be concluded that it is impossible to simultaneously determine the exact position and the exact momentum of a particle. So from these two concepts, that means narrow wave and the wide wave, the from the two concepts, it is very hard to find the measure the some position and momentum simultaneously. So Heisenberg uncertainty principle states that it is not possible to simultaneously measure the position and the momentum of a particle to any desired degree of accuracy. You know very well, you studied in your intermediate also this statement. In other words, the product of uncertainty in the measurement of position, that is delta x. Uncertainty in the measurement of position is delta x. And uncertainty in the measurement of momentum, that is delta p, is always constant. And it is at least equal to, not equal, at least equal to Planck's constant h. That is, it can be written as delta p into delta x is near equal to h. Generally we are writing, but it has been experimentally observed that the product of uncertainties in position and momentum is equal to or greater than h by 4. So the above equation can be written as delta p into delta x greater than or equal to h by 4. So this is the statement of Heisenberg uncertainty principle. This is the explanation of Heisenberg uncertainty principle. It is very, very important short answer. We can explain with the help of wide wave and the short wave. Okay. In the next class, we will discuss about Born's interpretation of wave function and its physical significance. That is nothing but we are going into the wave mechanics. And in that, we can discuss Schrodinger's time-independent wave equation and time-dependent wave equation. So we will discuss in the next class.